We have a regular session like this where we talked about some use cases that we are tackling at Dataiku and elsewhere. The one I'll be speaking about tonight is recent work that we've done in the finance space. So I don't know, who of you are working in financial services, roughly? Okay, so for those of you who don't, I'll start with the ground up. The application of machine learning here is for financial option pricing. And we'll use a technique that is now quite popular called generative adversarial networks. I don't know. Has anyone already worked with GANs? Okay. So well, that's understandable. It's this, the first paper on this was published 3 years ago, something like that. But there's going to be tons of industry application in the coming years. So I come from this not as a financier, but as an engineer. So we'll speak a bit about the Gaussian or normal assumption that is used in the used to be golden formula for pricing options, which is called Black-Scholes, which has shown a lot of limits. That's not a new thing for those of you who work in finance. So 3 years ago came generative adversarial networks as a new technique for simulation. So given these two facts, so me and another data scientist who was a trader before moving into data science, we actually managed in 10 days to deploy a demo project. And right now, this is running on every week on the last 10 years of the S&P 500. I'm not going to tell you if we are making money out of this. For now, it's an engineer project purely. So I'll talk a bit about the history of option pricing, introduce what does a GAN mean in the context of time series generation, and in the have 20 minutes. In the end, I'll do a quick demo of an interface to explain how it works and how potentially it can be used in traders' desks. So what is an option? You already know what is an option. So most people, so very simply, if you look at European option, because American options are a bit harder to explain, European options are just the right to buy a specific asset in at a certain price in a certain point in time. It's very, very important to get the value right from a trader perspective in order to be competitive at the market, and also for risk purposes, obviously. There are a lot of arbitrage out there that focuses on like a tiny variation of this evaluation. So there's already a lot of smart minds and lots of techniques that have been tried. So this is one of them. So the golden standard, I think this was a Nobel Prize in the 80s or 90s from Black-Scholes and Merton, actually, to be complete. Made was that a stock is a random walk, and the random walk is parameterized mostly by the volatility of the stock. So look at real stock. You can easily plot this. So this is the empirical view of stock. I don't know, it's a tech stock, if I remember correctly. You can measure what is called the adjusted returns. And if you look at log returns, it should be a Gaussian. So if you take that hypothesis for granted, Gaussians have nice properties. So it's easy to simulate them. So if you're familiar a bit with the random walk theory, so this is called a geometric Brownian motion, GBM, I'll use. And there is a little differential equation like this. But let's assume we are in a discrete time. And so now you have a formula for simulation. And then if you want to estimate the right price of an option, you need to compute the payoff. And depending if it's a put or a call, so if you buy or sell, it's very simple kind of, it actually looks like an activation layer in a way. So you put these two elements together and you have a very nice tool Monte Carlo. So Monte Carlo, you just do a lot of simulation of trajectory of a given stock. So you just simulate thousands of random walks. You compute the payoff for each of the trajectory, and then a reasonable evaluation of the price is can be the average of these simulated payoffs. So far, quite simple. So the theory is pretty good. The maths are simple. However, when you look at the empirical distributions of many stocks, there's a bit of a difference. So from an untrained eye, it might not seem like much. And if you look at the log returns here, on the left, it does look like a Gaussian. But when you really kind of simulate this the GBM given the volatility, so if you parameterize just by this, actually you have something a bit different. And notably, I want to point out a key difference, which is the width. So that characterizes it's something that on which I learned a lot thanks to my collaboration with someone with actual trading experience. Most of the time, the market is flat. So compared to a Gaussian, where you have kind of a lot of movement within the center, actually here you have most cases around zero. And then also, you have some rare event of market being optimist or pessimist, which are often underestimated by purely a normal curve. A lot of improvements, so different parameterization have been used. I'm mentioning Arch and Garch. But still, simulating these sorts of curves has never been an easy task. And it's still a hard task, to be fair. It's not that we've solved this. So enter generative adversarial networks. So if you're familiar with this painting, it's actually the first painting which was sold at Christie's. For I think, if I'm not mistaken, have it somewhere. I think it's 300,000 something. I don't have it. Yeah. Oh, 400,000. So interestingly, for reasons that are hard to explain, the art market does put a valuation of computer-generated art not to zero. This comes from the fact that this technique really originates from image generation. So there's another good example of that, which is slightly scary, which is this website. So this person is fake. So it does come from a lot of you know, understanding of a neural network of what does a human face is, but there's no one that exactly looks like this. Or maybe there is, I don't know. There you can write a science fiction book. So it works really, really well for image generation. So just to go a little bit on the structure of the network, I won't have time to go into big details, but know that the trick is to break down the network in two parts. Those are actually, there are steps. So you start just generating random data. Then you try to, you have a discriminator network that learns to distinguish generated and real data. So that's step one. So at the beginning, the generator is not trainable. And then at a second time, so at each batch, you actually this time say, okay, my generator is trainable. And then you backpropagate through the whole network. So you have times where you really consider and times where you don't. What you get out of it in the end, if you want to generate images, then you don't need the discriminator anymore. You just need the generator part. But thanks to the trick of having a discriminator, the weights that are learned by the generator are actually much better. This differs from there are other techniques that are more related to inversion, etc. But actually, this one had good empirical reasons. Results. What's interesting for the case of financial option is this trick is not specific to images. So you can use it to generate realistic enough curves of log returns. So we are dealing with the log returns, which is the basic element of simulation that Monte Carlo, that the Black and Scholes model in Monte Carlo is based on. So our plan for this specific GAN implementation was to take so daily historic price of the S&P 500 for 15 years. And we looked at, but it's an assumption, we looked at chunks of 50 days. So we said, okay, those are the real examples. We need to 50 steps of time save. Then, so you need to kind of initialize your training with a fake time series. So when we looked at this, we said, okay, what is a fake time series? It's actually, in a way, a choice that is as important as finding choosing the right prior in a Bayesian context. So then you perform as the regular GAN, you just train the discriminator. And so what is a bit hard with GANs is it's not completely obvious. There is a lot of research that goes into when do you stop? At this stage, just for the sake of time, the method that we use is we actually inspected the curves until we deemed that it was realistic enough. It turned out that in the end, when you look at simple distance metrics between empirical simulated by a GBM and simulated by a GAN, you actually do fit, you are closer to the empirical return curve. But there's definitely things we could have improved. here's the code. We are in the next month, in the next couple of months, we are going to publish some of that code. At this stage, it just exists there. But to begin with, our generator is extremely simple. It's just a sequence of dense with a bit of leaky ReLU layers. So leaky ReLU is, MacReve found that it worked quite well because otherwise it just doesn't converge. One tip that we used after tweaking and testing was not to initialize with just random noise. Otherwise, it's just the network would probably converge, but only after thousands of epochs. But we start with a GBM. So we on purpose say to the GAN, OK, you need to do better than the GBM. The discriminator is also the same. It doesn't even have a notion of time. And it's not even deep learning. You know, it's three dense layer. You could argue that it's just a regular. Don't forget the dropout. It does converge better with the dropout. And yeah, I have 5 minutes for a very quick demonstration. So, okay. All right. So this is built with a Bokeh. If you know about it, it's a pretty simple framework for developing quick prototypes of a web application using Python. And if I say I want to put for 100. And so this in blue is the empirical distribution of returns. And as you can see, so in this case, it didn't work so well. I could have taken another. Another example. Yeah, let me take another example. Sometimes it doesn't converge. I know Apple really converge well. Yeah, okay. In the backend, it's pulling an API in Dataiku that's simulating 10,000 trajectories on a GBM and on a GAN. So yeah, this one has converged better. And so you can see interesting elements in this graph if you're interested in how well the GAN has learned the distribution of returns. The first one is that, so in a bright yellow here, the GAN is much better at estimating the first fact that we had observed, which is that the market is most of the time flat. So here, actually, it's close to the empirical distribution. The other element that we observed, which was interesting, relates to the non-symmetrical nature of the GAN, which actually you kind of observe in most often pessimistic than optimistic, but you have bursts of optimism. So here, the GAN, for instance, kind of overdid this learning. So it's really, really asymmetrical to the left. So things to improve for sure, but it does better than GAN in this instance. If you look at the error, actually this case, okay. A bit more work to do on this one. Up maybe just a call. Up. It's also a matter of expiration days, so how many steps you need to simulate. Okay, yeah. So there are actually, and we were quite surprised in a good sense by it, quite a few differences between the estimations of the GAN and the GBM. So there's something that the GAN is able to learn a bit differently. So long story short, this was a 10-day project. So we are absolutely aware of the fact that this is not deep enough, that there are lots of improvements to be done in the architecture. Here's if you get the slides, here are some things that we are looking at in the future, specifically recurrent GANs. But as a conclusion, as a message for especially those of you who work in finance, these tools are all open source, free. They are extremely simple to put together. And we did this in 10 days. If you compare it to things that are used in production, well, and that kind of works, there are no reasons why you couldn't try and improve it. And that's it for me.